the risks of HRT that we were all scared about following, gosh, whatever it was, the giant nurses study from the late 90s or early aughts that convinced people that taking estrogen, even in relatively low doses, while you're going through perimenopause or menopause will cause cancer, turns out to have been bad research. And there is no evidence of this. I never expected to be someone who would end up taking anything. Because I don't, I have a lifetime of, you know, only taking things when I thought that they were absolutely necessary. But starting, 2019, I guess, I did start using estrogen patches because of specifically hot flashes and night sweats, like suddenly, like 40 a day. It was insane. And I looked into the research intensively for, you know, a number of weeks and went and talked to a few medical professionals whom I trusted with my papers in hand and was compelled that so long as you also supplement with progesterone, because you don't want the ratios to be wildly off of what they would be if you weren't supplementing with one or the other, at least you don't want an excess of estrogen. It seems to be actually mildly protective against some forms of cancers, and there was no evidence that there are negative effects, and the hot flashes went right away. I didn't have any of the other effects, so I can't speak to them, but I am compelled. I don't like the idea of injections at this point. Just don't trust it. I will say that it has since been suggested, actually, with regard to progesterone, and you don't want one of these implanted. Like, I don't trust implants, including like progesterone in the form of the Mirena IUD. There are a lot of things wrong down that road, which I'm not going to go into now. But there is a spray-on progesterone that actually might be useful for men and women, women and men alike, because progesterone is, yes, a sex steroid. Yes, women have more of it than men, but men actually have a fair bit, and all of our sex steroid hormones decrease with age, and progesterone has a number of salutary effects on both sexes.
All right, I will add a couple things. Mm-hmm. One, something about our story of menopause doesn't make any sense.
True.
Are people living in their natural habitat suffering debilitating hot flashes in their native habitat? It seems like bad design. So I don't quite buy that story until we have evidence that that, in fact, is a normal condition. So there's a question about whether or not the interventions that reduce the unpleasantness and debilitatingness of menopause and perimenopause, whether those things are correcting for a distortion of modernity or whether they are an intervention against a natural process we don't fully understand. I do think we essentially fully understand why menopause happens. I'm not talking about that.
You're not talking about the symptom.
I'm talking about the symptoms. I'm not talking about the process of going from a directly reproductive mode to a post-reproductive mode. Mm-hmm. But I think it's a fascinating mystery. There's something weird about this. That seems like way too much debilitation. And either there's a very good reason for it or it's new.
Yeah. Well, and, like all the other stuff associated with women-specific health, menses and gestation and childbirth to some degree, although that just sucks for everyone, I think, and perimenopause and menopause, there's wild variation in terms of what women experience. Mm-hmm. And I don't think I was conscious of thinking about it, but if I had been asked to predict, will you have, any extreme signs of menopause at some point, I would have said probably not, given that I had none of the other issues, right? Like I didn't have many of the problems that so many women legitimately deal with throughout their reproductive lives. So the fact that it's not necessarily linked to having had other reproductive health pain or inconsistencies or anything is itself interesting as well. That, yep. These things exist sort of piecemeal.
Yeah.